Soy loco por ti, América. Soy loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Soy loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Loco por ti de amores.
It is for me a great pleasure and an honor, truly, to participate in this generous call from AICA, the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation in Agriculture, as part of its sessions on interpreting, reflecting, acknowledging, and finding central themes in terms of our food realities globally, from each of the countries and with the interaction of those that know about the topic firsthand and that can contribute to this. I am Hugo Castellanos. I am a journalist specializing in agriculture from Argentina, living in Mexico now. And once again, I have to thank everyone for letting me participate in these sessions for AICA. In this case, we will be focusing on sustainable development, agriculture, and food in the new international context. Just to let you know how these coming minutes will work, we have two presenters that are of great importance and reputation internationally, given their experience, their knowledge, and their work in previous years. And at the same time, acknowledging why this is an important topic. We are in the midst of a complex reality globally of unprecedented characteristics worldwide, with the logical differences from one country to the other, but there's uncertainty, there's worriness, there's expectations, and a permanently constant concept of what will happen with the agri-food activities and how can we achieve the sustainable development we were talking about in previous years based on the fact that we now have a before and after of this reality. A situation that was already complex before the emergency and a present and posterior subsequent situation that will have several elements. I can think of, for example, development of soft skills, just to understand and give context and empathize to this new scenario. Another element, sustainability, thinking not just about the technical aspects only, but especially also looking at the implications of connecting health to agriculture, to good practices with sustainable development. And also food and how we feed ourselves. What's the role of food, considering the fact that many international experts around these times had started talking about the importance of having a good immunological system in your body to be ready to face contingencies such as the virus that is giving us the news today and probably will make the history lines. As we were saying, we have two valuable and brilliant presenters that in 10 minutes each approximately will give us their vision about this sustainable development, the view they have of food and diets in this situation and looking into the future. We have Ricardo Abramovay, author of Amazon for Economy and Nature and several books, Beyond the Green Economy, Solid Waste Management for a More Prosperous Society, that has been published in Portuguese and Spanish. His career in the University of São Paulo in Brazil, being a chair professor there and also a professor in the Institute of Energy and Environment, a person that covers all these aspects and that has developed a series of jobs linked to these We also have Guillermo Valles Carmes, a professional diplomat with over 35 years of experience providing services in several bilateral and multilateral diplomatic missions in Latin America, Asia, Europe, the United Nations. He's also worked with the establishment of Mercosur, the Uruguay Round, the beginnings of conversations between Mercosur and the European Union, in 2004, ambassador to the UN and the WTO, and other organizations internationally. So two very prestigious thinkers, two great personalities of the world of knowledge and management, diplomacy, that can provide us very clarifying thoughts and important insights on such an important key matter for our times, which will become news for 2020 and surely towards 2021, sustainable development, agriculture, and food in the new international context. First of all, I will ask Ricardo to speak, so that he can give us his vision about what we need to consider, and especially the necessary approaches with this type of scenario, with all the challenges that are crucial for us in our times. For sustainability, for the matters that we've been discussing for such a long time. Ricardo, it's a pleasure to have you. Thank you very much, Hugo. Thank you, Aika, for your invitation. It is truly an honor for me as well to be here and to share this space with Guillermo Valles. So it's wonderful to be here. Well, COVID-19 represents an important change, probably a turning point in how our contemporary world lives its relationship with nature. It's absolutely crucial. For this, there are two fundamental dimensions. First, our relationship with the animal world, and the second, our relationship with forests. Regarding our relationship with the animal world, there's three main ideas. First, we have to rethink what we eat and how we produce what we eat. There's no doubt that the worldwide agricultural system has achieved impressive success since the Green Revolution, with the impressive reduction of the problems with hunger and others. It's really today a shame that we have so many million people suffering from hunger even now. But this is just 10% of the worldwide population, and 40 years ago it was a third. But the global agricultural system and food system, even with its important achievements, was developed with three fundamental problems in tow. The first one is directly related to coronavirus, obesity. 40% of the North American population, over 30% of the British population, and almost 30% of the Mexican population suffer from morbid obesity. Although COVID-19 has the elderly as the main victims, or those most in danger, among the young adults and those that have been affected by this pandemic, the most serious cases are among those that have obesity. This has been seen very clearly in the south of the United States, for example. Cardiovascular disease, diabetes type 2, also increase risks of this pandemic. And where do we find obese people? They are not there where people eat wine, bread, and pasta like France, Italy, Portugal, and Spain. They're in the countries that consume food that is characterized by the most important scientists in the world as ultra-processed. In the United States, 60% of caloric intake comes from ultra-processed foods. In Great Britain, over 50%. In Mexico, over 30%. The agri-food system globally offers society today products that would be difficult to characterize even as food, to think up as food. And this brings along terrible and disastrous consequences. So this is a crucial everyday dimension of the relationship between society and nature. And this pandemic forces us to rethink about it. The second problem about what we eat and how we produce it are the greenhouse gas emissions. 70% of emissions from agriculture come from the ruminating animals. Protein from beef and sheep issues many more percentages if you compare it to, for example, poultry. If the herds of cattle of a world were a country, the emissions of methane especially would place it as the second most largest emitter after China. Recent work shows that the participation of ruminating animal beef or meat will have to drop from the current 9% to approximately 4%. If we wish to respect the limit of the median or average increase of worldwide temperature as per the Paris Agreement, this will have very serious consequences for countries that depend a lot on exporting beef. I am not necessarily promoting vegetarianism, but meat consumption will have to be reduced globally. Of course, for some parts of the population, it might have to increase, but globally, their proportion in worldwide protein will have to be reduced. A source that is so important for protein is also a vector of destruction for our common good, which is our climate system. So this just in itself invites reflection about the relationship between society and nature. The third problem is in the industrial production model for animal protein, based on gigantic concentrations of pigs and birds in the US and Europe, also ruminating animals. The progress of antimicrobial resistance in the world is already responsible for several deaths worldwide. An important report of the United Nations Environment Agency has recently showed us this. And many of the antibiotics produced worldwide are consumed by animals. And it's important to point out that this is not just something that environmentalists are worried about, and not just those that are working for consumer protection agencies or public health authorities. The Farm Animal Investment Risk and Return, a network of investors with a portfolio of over $20 trillion, is campaigning importantly on these matters, referring not just to the risks for human health of these types of production forms, but also raising concerns about the welfare, the well-being, and the dignity of animals. This topic 20 years ago was basically hippie or alternative. Today is definitely a mainstream topic in the global financial system. So, looking at global trade and the relationship with agricultural commerce is important. Just as we have stranded assets that cannot be realized in the world of fossils, FAIR estimates the risk of stranded assets in the world of protein production. But the relationship between society and nature does not refer only to what we eat and how we produce that. It also refers to our relationship with forests. In our case, in Latin America, the most important matter, and not the only one, of course, is the Amazon. Brazil was the country that between 2004 and 2012 gave the largest contribution to the fight against climate change by reducing deforestation by 80%. Basically, in the Amazon, of 20-something thousand square kilometers per year to less than 10,000. But starting in 2012, the trend has reversed. And last year, just in the Brazilian Amazon, deforestation achieved 10,000 square kilometers. In the first 3 months of 2020, deforestation in Brazil, in the Amazon in Brazil, was 50% larger than in the same quarter the previous year. In April, it was 60% more than April in 2019. I know that this is a global conference. We are not here to talk about specific governments. But in our case, there is no way of getting around it. The current government has definitely immobilized the state organizations that fought deforestation, and its discourse is inspired in ideas from the Cold War, and it is an incentive for the criminality, the invasion of public land, to become virtues. The invasion of indigenous territories is today being done by thousands of people, and there is no repression to that. The risks of genocide against the peoples of the Floresta of the Brazilian Amazon, especially indigenous peoples, are enormous, as have already been denounced by international celebrities that signed a manifest led by Sebastián Salgado. It is necessary to bring to the Amazon an economy with the knowledge of nature, not an economy destroying nature, which is being done today. This economy of knowing nature will allow us not just to develop food chains and value chains from products coming from the forest, but also maintaining ecosystem services through which all humanity can benefit and on which we all depend. But the fundamental condition is that policies for the Amazon come not from people that live in the world of the Cold War and that will never be able to conceive actions to have a world after this pandemic. Thank you, Ricardo. That is very profound, showing all your knowledge. And I think that it is very necessary, first, to thank you for sharing your thoughts. There are several points we would like to touch on later, and I do have some questions. So it would be good to consider later. So thank you, Ricardo. I will now give the floor to Ambassador Guillermo Valles. Again, he has vast experience internationally. And he can give us his insights, his vision, with the necessary broadness of mind needed for the challenges in the scenario we have today. And looking at sustainable development and how that sustainable development will be possible in agriculture, in food, once we have overcome this pandemic. Everyone is saying that around these times, many things are changing and many things will change. So with these changes coming, what can we do from the diplomatic arena, from public spheres, from public and private action, from citizens? How does food and sustainable development look to the future? So thank you, Ambassador. A pleasure to greet you. Thank you. The pleasure is mine. Hugo, Ricardo, again, also wonderful to hear you as well. And we will soon be exchanging some more points of view after I give my thoughts. I really appreciate, as Ricardo said, this invitation by AIC. I think these types of debates are very necessary now. And I will be explaining this throughout my presentation, why I think it's more important than ever. You asked a very key question, Hugo, on the changes. Ricardo has already mentioned this as well. I'd like to go deeper into this idea of change and looking at the international context, not just models, but the overall context, even outside our region. So the starting point is precisely that. This crisis, well, by definition, if we look at this etymologically, it is a moment of change, of existential shifts. There's a before and after. Even in the international system, of course, in national societies, for individuals as well, we are all talking about the new norm, the new normal. So the future will certainly be very different from the past, and it will be more different the longer this health crisis lasts and its effects on the economy given the recession. So the longer and more profound the crisis, the larger the changes, in my point of view. So the crisis will certainly bring new structures of power and alignments. At least history shows us this in the long term and contemporary history. Governance of systems, the context for a new model that Ricardo was mentioning, or any other new model, to a new development model overall, and then if we look at the agri-food part more particularly, you will find an international governance system that will be very different. And this was already happening, really. Coronavirus and the pandemic will alter the global order forever, period. We have to understand that and assume it. When we try to look into the future, and we see this kind of a forest, a misty forest of uncertainty that shrouds everything. That's the first element. But within that forest, misty as it may be, there is a first line of trees that we do see. And which are these? The trends that we already had before the crisis. The crisis will probably change some parts of this in how they're oriented or make them sharper, but they were there. And so we have to think about that in the international context. You also mentioned uncertainty, but we already had very strong uncertainty even before this crisis, even before the pandemic. In a crisis, the uncertainty you have in a crisis is very different from the economic uncertainty we had, for example, in the 2008-2009 crisis, where uncertainties were more financial at first and the contagion towards the economy later. So more economic uncertainties. On the contrary, what we had up to days before this health crisis was an uncertainty, politically speaking. So a political uncertainty that already had an important economic uncertainty. All projections for economic growth, everything that we had before, were trending downwards permanently. The IMF, in all its projections, every 3 months, it was adjusting downward because of the political uncertainty, not because of the fundamentals of conditions in productivity or the types of uncertainties we knew about, so to speak. So we do have to remember that first point. The pandemic is not necessarily just the pandemic, but all the trade-offs. And these all show that recession is a kind of health measure, if you will. It's a necessary health measure. So it doubly affects an international system that was already previously hit. If we remember something, the international system and all these organizational subsystems and the agreements, whether political, economic, and even environmental, were already being questioned by what I would call reactive or reactionary leadership. So the order and the existing pacts, agreements, whether the WTO, the United Nations, the Paris Agreement, they were being questioned. Questioned by more reactionary sectors, but also questioned by the visionary sectors as well. So the international governance system was already finding its limitations. Because it was not considered effective enough, ambitious enough, or simply politically questioned from a vision that I would call a reactionary. So we have the political uncertainty, and then we have this governance system that was finding its limits. That was already happening before the crisis. So again, comparing crisis, let's think about 2008, 2009, and what we have today. Political uncertainty, economic uncertainty, there's another element. And this is absolutely crucial to try and imagine our coming future. 2008, 2009 had at least a minimum of international cooperation, I think. And initially that was effective. We all remember when the United Kingdom called the G20, and again an example of how a crisis brings new governance systems, the G20 comes into scene, into play. I don't know if whether legitimately, illegitimately, but at least they emerged there. So that's important to remember, new forms of governance. And it's initially effective because there is that minimum of international cooperation, at least. And I do not see the same happening now. On the contrary, I think what we have today is a change in balance, shifting from that system that was questioned in its governance, but in the end still based on international cooperation, and now shifting to a system based on power relations. So from the Jovian world to or the perpetual peace world, Kantian peace world, towards a more Jovian world, where what we need is that big hegemon, and there's hegemonic forces. We have to accept this clearly and say it, because in this new system, there's a very complex governance structure where relations, power relations are more important or are being more important now than others. And this brings great complexities. If we think about Latin America and our agri-food system in Latin America, what is the international context we have today? That's why it's also necessary to bring dialogue, to cooperate within Latin America so that we can have a joint vision of our role within that international context. That is absolutely essential. That's why I think this conference is very important in that sense. If you allow me, Hugo, just two or three more points that, again, I think are absolutely relevant. How does this crisis find us? Another one of those trees that we can still make out in this misty forest that surrounds us. Well, clearly, production of food and agricultural and agri-industrial production, With all the criticisms we share, highlighted by Ricardo, we see that the economic sectors that are most affected by this historical and large recession we're seeing come from the more resilient sectors. If we think about economic recovery of countries, thinking about the need to produce food. So we all know that if we think about the balances I mentioned, on the one hand, the extreme, we have tourism as a sector that will absolutely be affected, or at least the type of tourism we traditionally knew until now. And on the other side of the spectrum, you have health systems and medical goods and services that are certainly going to be central to all public policies. And secondly, as Ricardo mentioned himself, what we eat, how we produce it, especially. And there, I see great potential for Latin America, especially if we rethink our vision about agriculture in Latin America and the Caribbean, trying to visualize ourselves as bioeconomies, incorporating many of the concepts that have been mentioned already by Ricardo. The potential will be greater the more we accept that economic model. In many of our countries, it's more implicit than explicit. But also in terms of the international context, I think we will have to revisit the concept of food security. Because the concept of food security we had until now, which was very good, multifunctional, multifaceted, that came about after decades of debate and definition, talking about economic and social access to food, enough and safe and nutritious food, there will be much more emphasis on nutrition and safety now, as we heard from Ricardo as well. But one concept that is not as clearly included in that food security definition that makes us more vulnerable in this international context: how we produce food. How is our food produced? It is not enough for them to be nutritious and safe and enough for us. We will have to reaffirm two aspects. First and foremost, that food security should not, and this is a big risk as agro exporters, should not be equated to self-sufficiency in terms of food. We have to acknowledge that if we want to maintain the intensive production of food that we need, and we want it to be sustainable, we cannot think about self-sufficient systems. We will need to depend on trade. More sustainable trade, of course, much more sustainable, and a concept of how we produce that is also more sustainable. And we don't have that yet included in the current concept used by FAO. And lastly, and not least important, what I see is that this will require a whole system of standards, public standards and private standards. And there's no uniformity or convergence around these standards. On the one hand, we have the precautionary European system that in many cases does not have enough science behind it. And on the other side, we have a fragmentation, regulatory fragmentation of public standards, but also private ones. And the only thing that this does is benefit fragmenting of markets, also benefiting concentrations of power and the large distributing chains. So we will have to work very strongly, first, on defending a concept of food security that encompasses also sustainable production and sustainable forms of production for food. Second, we will have to defend an international system where there is very little international cooperation today. And third, we need a trade system, an interdependent system that is very fragmented in its regulations today. So most definitely, to close my first presentation and later coming to questions, I believe that our agricultural systems will have to be based on our own genuine endogenous science, so that we can, among other things, measure, adequately measure, and not based on patterns coming from the north, but looking at our own sustainability standards based on our own realities. Because I perfectly understand what you were saying, Ricardo, in terms of the deforestation of the Amazon. But with all the scientific arguments, I can defend the Pampian agriculture, the pasture, natural pasture livestock farming that we have, and soil protection in the southern parts of South America and the southern cone. And I think those are not well reflected in the patterns used by productive systems that are intensive and using science from the north. So there is a very important task ahead of us. And very clearly, Hugo, to close, the world, with or without the pandemic, with or without the recession, first, we'll have more population every day, it will increase, climate change will continue, and evolution, technological evolution will continue. So we have to incorporate those three variables, because they are trends that will not go away, so that we find a globalization system that won't turn back either, but wishing it to become more sustainable. Thank you very much, Ambassador. It gives us a very general, broad view that we need to have based on your experience and your knowledge, and of course on how you observe the landscape today and towards the future. If you allow me just to add to the variables you're saying, the issue of health. Health very closely linked to safety and food safety and food security. So thank you, Ambassador. I have some questions now for you to delve deeper into some of the aspects. So Ricardo, regarding your presentation, I have a very basic conclusion, or the first reference at least, just to synthesize. We are talking then, Ricardo, about producing well, but consuming better, without forgetting that we need to care for resources effectively, I would say. Am I right? Yes, no doubt about it. Those three demands, if you will, producing well, and this means not just not damaging society or not damaging others, but producing in a regenerative way, that's essential, consuming well and better for your health, and also preserving the ecosystem services, depending on nature, really, on forests, but also from agriculture that offers its important ecosystem services. So this is not something that you can reduce to trade-offs. There's no real dilemma here in the sense that you produce a bit better, but if you do, you would have to lose something in terms of quality or prices. No. What happens currently with food and low-cost protein and with the advance of these ultra-processed foods, generally, low prices are vectors not for better food consumption, but actually vectors for diseases. And for drastic diseases in terms of our global health system, what the world has to spend on cardiovascular disease and type 2 diabetes, and the relationship of that with food and what we eat, is impressive. So there, I think the ambassador is very correct in what he said, bringing value to how the pampas, the great pasturelands in the south, produce. The difference is that in the north, the breeding of ruminating animals is done in conditions that are environmentally unsustainable. And in Latin America, we have the advantage and the opportunity of offering to the world meat that is produced in conditions that allow regeneration of ecosystem services. And if I understood correctly, I fully agree with Ambassador Valles in that sense. Yes, that's very important to consider. And it also involves the general recognition of that balance that we need to consider, Ricardo. Producing without forgetting something as essential as health, especially given the situation we have today, caring for our resources as well, to be able to have that true sustainability. Yes, there's two important equations. First is the relationship between society and nature, and the second is the relationship between economics and ethics. In this world that is heading towards 10 or 11 billion inhabitants, the economy cannot just be the dimension of life that offers employment, income, taxes, and some technological innovation. In a world with 2 billion inhabitants, that might be other way. It is not longer the case. We need to evaluate the quality of what economic life offers to society. And in the agri-food system, that quality will have to be reconsidered. And the pandemic just brought this to surface. Ambassador, a question for you. It should be an easy one. In this volatile context, in all the complexities we have politically and functionally, in the already complex world we had before this, what can we expect for the day after, if you will, for the post-pandemic world, looking at public policy interaction with private sector, having points of agreement, necessary points of agreement, probably urgent points even, so that we can now definitely think about sustainability to the future. So, Ambassador, with your experience, what scenario will we find in future after this time that has had such an impact throughout society and in political activities in the world? Well, two things, Hugo. First of all, it's not after the crisis. Recovery is not a phase. When you talk about post this, post that, what do we mean with that? What is post? Post is today. We're already here. Resilience, recovery, they're not phases that start and stop and end when the other one started. It's just simultaneous functions, really. So today we have to think about today. And how we maintain ourselves today, our economy, our health today has to be such that will not affect economic recovery. So resiliency and recovery are not faces that are juxtaposed and that will be left for tomorrow. We have to start building them today. And there's many things we can do internationally, regionally, nationally. We've been working on this already. And I just think that the pandemic is more of a catalyst for many of these things. So nationally, public policy. Of course, this is a very Uruguayan vision. Of course, I'm from Uruguay, but I'm trying to think about all of Latin America and the Caribbean. I insist on this concept. We have to see ourselves as bioeconomies. In the case of countries such as Brazil, that has a productive matrix that is so much more complex than Uruguay's, you might think it's not as urgent, but I think it is urgent in all countries, in more or less of a magnitude. In Uruguay, it's absolutely essential because we are basically an agri-food producer and a service producer, and services related to the agri-food system as well. Also creative industries, etc., but essentially as that. So looking at ourselves as bioeconomies, promoting investment and employment, and of course that's a great concern now, employment and economic recovery, but going deeper into clean, sustainable production with renewable biological resources. And this is throughout the chain. And Ricardo said it, and I fully agree. These are just opportunities. They're opportunities because we can create value if we appreciate not just human health more, but the health of our whole system. Health as an overall theme. This will bring economic health as well. So promoting investment and employment in clean, sustainable production of our biological resources. So having that concept of bioeconomies, thinking of ourselves like that, that's rethinking of ourselves as that. Secondly, and very closely related from the economic point of view, we all talk about the competitiveness agendas, and it's fine, it's reasonable, but there is where we have to clearly insert the idea not just of costs for a country, as we see in Brazil, Argentina, Uruguay, the whole region. The country cost has to include the variable of sustainability. How would you include that, Ambassador? Well, first of all, measuring what we're doing and looking at the impact of what we're doing, the impact of our agricultural production, and measuring this based on standards, as I said, and I insist, that we have created from our region with our productive system based on our own science that we have and is strong and good. We have national research institutes and agricultural institutes, standards coming from us that can truly measure the effective contribution in terms of greenhouse gas emissions and also in capturing these and measuring this in sustainability so that we can prove it. So not just measuring it, but certifying it, having standards to certify it based on our own forms of production. Now, this is not meaning to freeze what we're already doing, but just to improve and enhance what we're already doing. So just as an example, Uruguay. Uruguay has a very, very good policy in terms of soil protection. And it has tax incentives for anyone certifying their good practices. A soil policy that I dare to say competes with Europe and other regions of the world. So we will have to improve that even more and to certify it so that we can transform it. There's no trade-offs. It's just adding more value because consumers, as Ricardo said, and also investors are looking for that because they also know that it's an existential risk for them. Professor Ambassador, a last question, bringing us to why we are talking about this point on sustainable development, agriculture, and food in the new international context. From each of your points of view and your visions, which do you consider are the three key elements to work on that sustainable development for food, for production going forward? What are the three most important aspects that the public and private sector have to define? First, Ricardo. I fully agree with the words from the ambassador. And just to add one dimension, Latin America lost the race of global competitiveness. Looking at Asian countries, we lost the race to them 30, 40 years ago. So we will never recover that position with microchips or computers or anything. But bioeconomies are fundamental. These are the greatest opportunity for Latin America to give us a place at the forefront of innovation, technological innovation even, worldwide. This is already being done in part in research institutes such as Embrapa, INDE in Argentina, and all Latin America. But this does not yet include, and because it is very difficult, is the bioeconomy of biomes that are not yet sustainably used or exploited, such as the Amazon. This is strategic for the pharmaceutical industry, for the chemical industry, and for the creation of new value chains, where these biomes, especially the Pan-Amazon, covering 9 Latin American countries, can offer. The second thing, most importantly, is that we cannot base what place we have internationally in a competitiveness that is only based on bad working conditions, destruction of nature, etc. On the contrary, we have all the possibilities of having an agriculture that is based on the regeneration of nature, the value of knowledge and information. And that's why the economy of knowledge of nature and not the economy of destruction of nature is so important for our agricultural and food sector. And thirdly, I think that we need to reflect on what agriculture overall offers to society today and the risks that come along with that in terms of human health and animal dignity, as we are hearing from investors from this network I mentioned, FAIR. So these three elements are essential. Unfortunately, they require, and I fully agree with the ambassador there, they require multilateral cooperation. And sadly, this is no longer in the landscape of many of our governments and leaders. Thank you, Professor. Ambassador, what do you consider would be the three central elements for these the possibility of this sustainable development in agriculture from your point of view? I guess we could close with Ricardo's words, really. But if you're asking me and you want me to contribute, I would highlight again in the multilateral context, we need to avoid thinking that food security is being self-sufficient nationally. That has very, very high risks linked to it. To say it clearly, if Europe thinks that you can do this going back because of the dangers of depending on others for your food, that you will produce everything for yourselves, that's an ecological disaster, a disaster for health, and for many other aspects. So we cannot do that. We have to avoid that idea that food security is self-sufficiency. Secondly, that brings us to international dependency on some products more or less. And so there, we have to offer all the guarantees we can, not in terms of quantities or affordability, but especially we have the potential that no other region has, the natural potential, the scientific potential to change that paradigm of agricultural production to make it more sustainable. So, first, again, multilaterally, forgetting about the idea that food security is being self-sufficient. Nationally, we have to prepare ourselves for that change. What Ricardo mentioned of that culture of knowledge of nature and working with nature, I would add. To give a brief definition, adopting a model of the bioeconomy, sustainable bioeconomy, intensification of food production will certainly come. Because even if we have the best distribution of food today, as Ricardo said, they're not necessarily safe, or we don't have the ideal distribution. So we have to work on that as well. But especially clean production. And I insist on certification, proven clean production. They demonstrated with science, with our own science, showing what our good practices are. And more than just practices, again, is that reconversion, rethinking from our countries, how we can intensify our production. So, food security, secondly, nationally speaking, adopting that concept, a clear concept, and visualization of ourselves as bioeconomies. And thirdly, based on a system with standards and certifications to promote that we're not just, as they say, of CSER, not just innocent, but that we can prove ourselves innocent. Yes, very graphic explanation. Thank you. And then it invites me to reflect. It's up to me to have our closing reflection. So first of all, the conceptual and expressive quality, the knowledge that we have here with both our guests. Thank you very much for giving us your time and sharing your thoughts with us, for having participated and shared your views, so necessary now in this very complex and difficult time. As a journalist, you sometimes try to bring some words in that are not very common, but 2020 is definitely a complex year and difficult for everyone, all human beings. It's inviting us all to have an introspection, probably unprecedented for all of us. And it's bringing us to new dimensions and to rethink the world we live in since January or later on, depending on where we are. But in terms of what we are discussing today, sustainability, food, agricultural production, from what the professor and ambassador have shared with us today and very clearly explained, almost didactically, something that is very important in these types of activities. So I would like to highlight the need to connect production, agriculture, and health. This is already, it was already being mentioned, but of course now, going forward, it will certainly be incorporated into the matters of agriculture, how we connect health and agriculture with health. So it's both ways. The second element, an effective agriculture with good sustainable practices as agri-food systems. So understanding sustainability broadly, taking care of the soil, of water, and looking at all the challenges brought about by changes in temperature, climate change, but also caring for the consumer and thinking about consumers' health, because they are the ones that will eat the food and that might have a more or less healthy life based on the diet available to them, and of course, based on what they know. I'm sure there will be an opportunity to talk about labeling and different standards and rules that will have to come about for better informed consumers and for producers that will know how to cater to this based on knowledge, based on standards, finding a way to satisfy, if you will, the consumer that will be more demanding. And something I would also like to highlight is the bioeconomy, the concept of bioeconomy, a modern economy that is based on this 21st century reality, forgetting about the previous dichotomies that did not give us much, and so bringing a more global, holistic vision for the long term. I think these will be the topics in the agenda for science, for research, for academia, even for the political side, functionally, for diplomacy. These are all big challenges. And I have to say this also for journalism and for communicators, for institutional communications and communication within organizations that are directly or indirectly linked to food production. The big challenge there is to have an intelligent and concrete message that comes. And the message is that we need a sustainable agriculture that cares for resources with sustainable agri-food systems, with robust industrial activity in agriculture, because this generates employment, but we also need consumers that can find healthy food that is safe for them. From my point of view, that's one of the possible perspectives in the coming world after we've gone through the most critical part of this global health emergency. Once again, thank you very much, Professor Ricardo Abramovay, Ambassador Guillermo Valles, and of course the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation in Agriculture, for allowing us to interact and hear from these presenters with all the questions I have now. And thank you for this interaction and just this channel to help us share knowledge with two presenters that are so prestigious internationally and that help us think, that help us reflect, and will help us find that sustainable development. Thank you so much, Professor Ambassador, for your participation.
Muchísimas gracias.